climbing to get there. So that.
Yeah,
it's going.
All right.
It's got 10 seconds.
Yeah.
Is it working yet?
It crashed. Thank you everyone for coming along. A little bit of a nice impromptu presentation from some of our usual ones. Done as part of the SDR Special Interest Group today. I'd like to welcome Scott, VK7HSC, along. Scott's been involved with Packet Radio for a very long time now. In fact, a lot longer since I've had a ham radio license. And so today he's going to take us through some of the history of packet radio and some of the cool stuff and how easy it is to get involved with it right now. So take it away, Scott. Thank you.
Thank you. Yay! Woo! Okay. As the question is, what is packet radio? It is just one node available to us. See my nerves since it's kicked in already. It's one of the many digital modes available within amateur radio. Packet radio goes back to about 1983 when it became general use. It was experimental throughout the late 70s or thereabouts. We're stating here that it's got a 100% error free. That's not quite correct, but it does have error correction on each packet in a particular mode. To achieve that, you'll have a chunk of data and it just breaks it up into small little bits and will send those over the air. You also, it runs on two tones to give you a binary 0-1. For VHF, it's usually 1200 Hz, 2200 Hz, and on HF, it's a 200 Hz split. And the tones there vary depending on the model of device you're using, but they're either 1600 or 1800, or 2110 or 2310, and there are some others which have some weird configuration as well. The ones that usually, for example, the PK232 there, that has the 2110, 2310. Some radios don't like tones that high up. Frequency, kind of, you can have some issues with the radio pre-emphasis, de-emphasis on that particular tone range. So that's why later manufacturers brought the tones down into a more lower range where they're a little bit more acceptable. Anyway, covered that. Right, so a packet usually will start here. We're pretending this is the whole packet. It starts off with a flag, then it'll have a header payload, which is the data that you're actually sending. That little thing that Ben's put on there is covering what that says, but that, you can't see it either. that's basically checksum, a red piece there, and then tailing flag. The only thing this thing here doesn't show is there's also a preamble prior to the flag, and that is basically a toggle between the 0-1 and letting you know that there is a packet about to start, because packet is synchronous, so each packet has to be in sync to receive.
Is that right? Like I say, I'm not quite sure where the little badge is coming from, because it's not me.
Oh, okay. Well, it ain't me. Right.
That's a bit scary.
Must be. It's got to be in the overhead.
That's Google branding, I see.
Right, yeah, so this is kind of a pictorial thing of how a modern day packet radio station would exist. You've got the traditional route, and more, this is the way people, the majority of people are doing it these days. On this side, you have a PC, it can be anything, dumb terminal, PC, Mac, whatever, doesn't matter. This here is a TNC, or terminal node controller. This here is essentially, it's a modem, And that does the conversion of your serial data to transferring it to audio tones, which you then plug into your radio, which in turn goes out over the air. Whereas on this side, the PC is doing the lot via your sound card, like you would with the PSK31 and the other modes in that kind of field. Now, the link here is showing that there's a BBS, that'll be covered a little bit later, and that this is a station that either is connected to it at a given time. Some of the software that was specifically written for packet radio is kind of circa late 90s, early 2000s, and a lot of it has basically stopped development at around about that stage. There are still a few things that are in active development, but not much. Packet radio really had its heyday in the 90s, and that's pretty much where it stayed.
Is that another internet victim then? Is that what you're
implying? Yeah. Purely just out of the fact that internet speeds were faster. You could do more with the internet. Packet radio, you were fairly limited on what you could do. Right, covering what the frame is. I didn't really take a close look at this, but so there's three types of frames contained within the packet. There's information frames, unnumbered frames, and supervisory. Now, I'll start with unnumbered, which is essentially like UDP with TCP. So it's a frame that is just sent out, and there is no required acknowledgement on that frame. Supervisory frames are connect requests.
On cue.
Here's some
And information frames are where you're passing data from one point to another. And they are numbered in a sequence. So.
That makes much noise.
Right, yeah, I'm just trying to make sense of this line here. So you have your destination, SSID, which is secondary station identificator. In packet radio, you can have, you picture it as your call sign, and then you have a minus, and then from essentially 0 to 15. 0 is just dropped, it's just as your call sign. That is an SSID, it's an extension of, so you can essentially have 15 packet stations addressed to you in that kind of logic sequence. In practice though, you don't, but it is a possibility. If you had multiple services, you would want them all on individual SSIDs so they're separated. You'd be struggling to use all 15 in one go. So, because that there is covering half that, I'm not sure what it's actually a critical bit on the bottom line there. But this top line here is just explaining a connection. So, you've got your calling, it's your destination, the source. If there's a digipeater in the mix, if the digipeater has an SSID, now 7 down to 0. This is your numbered information frames. Then payload, which is obviously the bulk of what you're sending within it, CRC frame. And that's about that. Now, I know that's not a very good explanation of it, but in a pictorial way, that kind of explains how how the breakdown of that actually works. A good example for unnumbered frames is APRS. APRS uses exclusive unnumbered packets. There's no connected mode in APRS, whereas BBS style packet is you connect to a station and you're passing data point to point. APRS, you are simply broadcasting, whether it be a message, a position, an object, whatever. So, what can you use packet radio for? I started to actually cover that in the previous. You can just do a keyboard to keyboard where you'll have person A, person B. They can start at their station. In this pictorial, it's showing that they're actually doing two digi hops to get to each other. And digis are a fancy way of saying a repeater. So you go from there and it just simply hops to the person. And when you're in connected mode like this, you literally, on your, depending on what kind of program you're using, if you're generally using a terminal program, you just have a blank screen and just, your text will just appear sequentially. So it's like that. Now, most TNCs have what's called a PMS, personal mailbox, and you can actually connect to that and send, it's the equivalent to an email, but without all the headers and rubbish. So that is also a possible thing. And then it covers there about nodes. Now, unfortunately here in the south of the Tas, there is no packet nodes that I'm aware of. I started to set one up and then the Raspberry Pi I was doing it on decided to kill the SD card and I didn't get a chance to back it all up, so I haven't rebuilt that yet. So, chat servers, okay. We'll cover that. There are items on packet radio called chat servers. Again, in Hobart, there is nothing on air that actually is. Oh, hang on, no, Danny would have some. He's got a DX spider, which is similar to a chat server. Not sure what it's on, though, as far as SSID. Danny has multiple systems on.
I think it's on his Dash 2.
Dash 2, is it? Okay, yeah. You'd have to check with Danny with how he's running things. I've got no idea. I don't actually have a path to him at home, so I can't.
Danny has a lot of IDs.
Yeah, I don't have a path to him, unfortunately. Yeah. I do receive packets from him, but obviously I'm not making it back up to him.
Okay.
Which is unfortunate. So, yeah. When you're doing on a chat server, it is like old internet chat, where it appears like so. The focus of this particular frame wasn't really well enough to cover, so I'll skip that. Right, so this is where I started to mention about a BBS before. So, a BBS is dedicated software that is, I don't know, if you remember FidoNet, those who remember FidoNet, well,
absolutely.
That's scary.
A BBS has a similar functionality to that. In fact, most of the software that was written for the BBSs for amateur were based upon a FidoNet style of system, where you could send and receive messages, you could send out bulletins, you could upload files, download files. Generally share information in a way that people don't know about these days. So what this information here is, this is the kind of thing you would see when you connect it to an FBB BBS. FBB was written by a French guy, Jean, I forget his surname, F6FBB, anyway. He basically stopped development of the BBS in the early 2000s, and it's kind of gone into the open source realm, and there's not really been much done to it, because it's kind of got developed to a point where it really couldn't go any further. The only thing they did was port it from DOS to Linux and make it compatible that it could also be run on a Mac. That's about the only updates that happened to it in the early 2000s. So, in this particular case, this is the kind of information you would see. For example, when it's connected, it's given a little greeting saying, hello, you're using channel 16 of this particular system. There are, you know, as you can see on the thing, 800 new messages. And you last listed such and such. And it's just mentioning what you're on. Not all BBSs would look like this, because this is a specific setup with the host mode. And this is what a line would look like of a message. So you've got a message number, its type, whether it's personal, bulletin, to and from, and the BBS that it's being held on. In this case, it just happens to be the same call signs there. Date and time that it was received at the BBS. The title of the message, which I'm guessing just says greetings. And the LC choice is irrelevant in this particular case. And it would prompt you saying you've got one unread message, and you get a prompt like this. So that is BBS. Now that is in connected mode, where you are physically connected from one station to another, and in between point to point there is error correction from you to the BBS. I think there's a slide next that covers that in a bit more detail. It's going into its clusters, sorry. That continues on from like chat servers related. So you as a station connect to a DX cluster, and I must admit I've not spent a lot of time on DX clusters, but just trying to think of the name of the website. There's one that where you can report in band activity within Australia.
VK Logger.
That's it.
Yeah.
VK Logger is essentially a DX file. So using that system would be very familiar if you're actually using a DX spider. That's exactly like that kind of a system. The only difference is, instead of being on the internet, you're doing it on a packet radio. Pretty much covered this one just a few minutes ago, but APRS. There's one specific thing with APRS that I'll mention. We use the term digipeters, and digipeters usually would have a call sign. Now that can either be a personal call sign or a repeater call sign, depending on the situation. With APRS, it's designed in such a way that aliases are generic, so that you as the user don't have to know the digipeters in the local area. So if you're travelling, you don't know how to address your packet. So there are generic aliases that all the digipeters would share, that you set up a particular path and it gets propagated throughout the system that way. Try and only cover it, not explain it in detail. The general aliases are, well, the old ones used to be relay, trace, and wide. And the specifics of those was a trace used to leave the digipeter's call sign in the path, so you could physically trace back the path that you took. Wide would just be a blind digipeter, no trace. And relay was essentially like a fill-in first hop for if you're a low-power station, somebody else is a more base station arrangement, you could relay through them and then go beyond. That then changed about 10 years ago, I think. That system became a bit redundant in that it just wasn't working out too well. So they then came up with a new system where they used a countdown piece on the end. So they changed wide, and then you ended up with, you could have up to 7-7, which would be 7 actual digipeats. Generally though, you would use 2-2 or 3-3. You wouldn't generally go above that because you're just kind of propagating your information.
What are the two numbers, Luke?
It's a countdown. So,
well, that one just says 2-1.
Yeah, well, that would have originated as 2-2, and when it got digipeated by this one here, it's dropped the 2 down to a 1, and then in this particular case, it's been gated to the internet. But if there was another digipeter there, that would then go to wide 2-star. meaning that the packet has, the counter has expired, and any other digipeters in that chain would then just discard that packet and ignore it. That's to kind of keep a packet within a zone. So if you had a network set up where you had, say, five digipeters, and you're in the centre, you propagate out, they propagate out, and the amount of hops you do determines how far you go out of that particular thing. With APRS, you generally only want to keep your information within range of an iGate, because there's no point really propagating yourself. For example, I'll use Tassie as an example. You're here in Hobart, you put out a wide 7-7, and if it just happens to make it through a few digipeters that are in the chain, your packet could end up on the northwest coast, but it's competing with other traffic in the area.
Having it's like a zone kind of control.
Yeah, it's like trying to keep it in a cell.
Time to live, which is a time.
That's what I said. It's a subnet.
You are trying to. You're trying to keep it within an area.
Less than three.
And in this particular case, this is all unconnected, so JBlogs has gone through one digi to another, and then there's what's called an APRS iGate, which is just gating the information sent in this particular packet. I'll explain that packet in a moment. To the internet. So in this case here, it's originated from this guy, this two field, and this field are part of the actual packet being sent. This is what's called a MIC-E packet, and it's specific to APRS. It's a compressed packet. So the actual two field and the actual data here, when decrypted by APRS programs, give you the latitude, longitude, speed and heading of that particular station there. In this case, old convention for -9 was it's a car. So that particular person's on the moon. Code is used internally within iGates to let other systems know that that packet came in through me and don't spit it back out into the RF field. Right, this is connected packet where you're actually going from one to another. In this particular field here, you start off here and you've got digipeter. Now, you would start off here, you bounce, get to your end, then they send the ACK going back to you. If there was a drop packet somewhere in the chain, the originating or end station have to request that drop packet again. So the two digis in the middle here are basically just repeating the originator and destination. They don't do any error checking in this chain. It's very inefficient, and there are other ways, which is on the next slide, as to how to improve that. So in this particular case, as mentioned, they would send via two digipeters to the end station. Now you've got to think of your actual packet length, and you get there is a number of the maximum amount of stations you can have on a single frequency, and I think from memory, I think it's 1024. But realistically, that would be impractical because of all your time slots, you'd definitely have a lot of collisions. But that's a theoretical thing. So, I've just covered that, so that's that. Okay, now, we don't have any data regenerators in this particular circumstance. I would use a different term for this one, not a regenerator, I'd call it a crossband link. So it's going from one frequency to another. In this particular slide, on the northwest coast, north of Sydney, on part of their network, they've got a regenerator here that they're calling it. They're basically shifting a packet frequency from one to another. You could pretend, or not pretend, you can imagine that as being a zone, a packet zone. So you've got one frequency for one given area and another frequency for another given area, but this is a crossover link to join the two together. Again, we don't have anything like that here, but that is possible to do. Ah, this is the one that I thought was going to be the next slide. Okay, now in this particular example, you've got nodes in between endpoint. So, in this case, this station here connects to the node. Then there is error correction between this point and this point.
Locally.
Right, then if you needed to go to there, in this particular case, using NetROM, the nodes know how to talk to each other. They have a particular, it's not really a protocol, but they have information that they beacon out that makes sense to another node. And basically, it's like an address book. So even though these are unnamed, this node would know how to talk to that node and vice versa.
So it's a route table.
It's a routing system, yeah. So you'd connect to the node and you wanted to connect to this end person. So then you connect via this node and it then knows how to take the path and jumps through. In this particular case, in all hops, there is error correction on every step. So if an error happens between originator and node, it would fix it up within that point there. If this person dropped a packet from this one here, instead of it having to bounce all the way back, it's just simply fixed up at the end. Now, there used to be a good system set up in Tassie with, it wasn't NetROM, it was using ROSE, which is a very similar thing. And there used to be a ROSE link between Hobart and Launceston. Sadly, it doesn't exist anymore. That used to be really good because you could get, obviously, from Hobart to Launceston via ROSE node.
What frequency was that?
That used to be on 144.9.
Okay.
That's where the call sign RAD comes from.
From Goldfields?
Yes, that's where it used to be.
Okay.
And how did you get to Launceston?
Used to get into Mount Barrow.
Yeah, well,
RTY used to be on Mount Barrow. And so the two ROSE nodes basically always had a permanent connection to each other. So that when you connected to the ROSE nodes, this is the difference with ROSE, if you knew another ROSE node you wanted to connect to, you could type in its particular identification. Or if you just wanted to connect to a station, you could do that as well. It wasn't as clever with routing as say, NetROM, but similar. ROSE would use an alphanumeric identifier, specific identifier. So does NetROM, but it does it in a different way. This is the advantage with a connected packet. Obviously, you've got your error correction between point to point, which would then mean, obviously, if you've got an error, like in that previous example, if the error happened in the middle, beginning to end, we'd have to sort that out. But this particular one, it's node to node, node to station that will sort it out. So even if there was an error between node to node, they'd still negotiate to say, oh, hang on, I dropped a packet there, can I have it again? Yeah, I hope that makes sense. Alright, okay, this is going into using AX25 over the internet. Where you can have a gateway, I haven't set one up yet, but I'm in the process of going to do so, where you can essentially pass TCP/IP traffic over the radio. Now, it's not going to be overly effective. In fact, it's probably going to be near useless, but it's more just if you wanted to try and ping something or something like that, that's what I'm aiming to do it for, is really basically pinging and or trace routing. Instead of actually trying to pass, say, hypertext or anything like that, because forget it, it's not going to work. Too slow. The one thing I didn't mention, this key word here, AX25. It's not a protocol as such, it's a link layer definition. So, those in the know would know that about X25. Well, AX25 is a variant of X25 with a few modifications to make it relevant to amateur radio.
Is the dot significant? Is that why body slammed
up? No. X25, yeah. that's how that's presented.
No, but I'm thinking of the one underneath it. Why is that not? So it says AX25, there's no dot there. Why is it?
It's a typo.
I think that is a typo, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Good question. Not my slide.
X.25 makes sense, the one underneath it.
Yeah. Pretend there's a dot there, for intents and purposes. So AX25 is a variant of X25. The main difference is X25 has a 12-character station identifier. And there's a few other small points that are slightly different. Like in X25, you don't have... I don't think you've got unnumbered frames.
No.
I can't remember. I can't remember the specifics, but anyway, there's a few small modifications to the X25 protocol that we've done to make it all happen. That is actually now the limitation of why packet radio has basically died, because you can't pass enough data over an AX25 system. Plus, the majority of them are limited to either 1200 baud, majority of stations are 1200 baud. If you're on HF 300 baud, you can imagine the time it takes to pass information from point to point. You've got to be dedicated if you're trying to send a 1 meg file over HF.
We'll never want more than 640k.
True. I remember in the good old days where you have HF forwarding between BBSs, and they'd be hammering 24/7. Just passing data to it from the BBS to a BBS.
At 300 baud.
Trying to keep up. Yeah. Crikey. When I ran a BBS, I used to do all my mail forwarding over the internet, but I was dealing on average about 10 meg of mail a day. That's how much mail was going in and out of the BBS. When I say mail, that's just bulletins, messages, general rubbish that half of it I wasn't interested in, but I did it as a I wanted to do this at that time anyway. So if you imagine trying to pass all that mail forwarding over HF at 300 baud, the backlog, you'd still be trying to pass
it. Shot.
Yeah, no, you wouldn't. So you would filter out what you wanted to pass. Generally over HF links, it was personal mail only. Bulletins and that were usually transferred over VHF, UHF, or faster speed. That's the other thing about speeds. Covered 300 baud, 1200 baud. You've also got 24, 48, 96, 192. I think the highest packet radio's ever been used on is 38.4?
Right.
38 something?
38.4.
Yeah, I think that's the fastest that's ever actually been used.
What did they use that on ever?
10 gigs. Yeah. The higher the bandwidth, obviously, the more bandwidth of RF you need. Just trying to think, 9600, you use 8 kilohertz. So, yeah, you'd need a considerable amount of data. I forget what slide we're on, but I think we're getting close to the end. Ah, okay. This isn't really relevant to Hobart. This is kind of how they've structured a system in the north of New South Wales. So I'm not 100% familiar with where these would be within Sydney, but we'll pretend that one's the Sydney one. That's actually a club station, the NB, Manly. So let's pretend that's the central node. You've got a BBS, that's that one where they've got the cross thing. You've got another BBS, which is, I'm assuming that one was, say, on that frequency, this one was on that frequency. In this case here, you've got an internet tunnel connecting from that to that. And so basically a mesh network is the easiest way to describe it. That is the best way to describe packet radio, too. Actually, it is essentially a mesh network where... Yeah, pretty much it. This is basically covering AX25 over TCP/IP. It can be done in two ways. It can either be done on RF, which is very slow, or over the internet. And that's generally how it's done, is over the internet. You would have an entry point on RF, but majority of the time it would just be over the internet. Going back to those chat servers / DX spiders, they operate over Telnet. So majority of those are accessed on the internet these days.
Do you know the irony there is I spent a lot of my early days doing IP over X25.
Yeah.
The companies that were getting into IP-based environments, what they use,
exactly,
the packet switching networks.
Yeah, yeah.
It's flipped over now.
It's basically gone full circle. I mean, this AX25 over IP stuff it's not common, but it is an option. I'm trying to get it set up here and hopefully get something working again. Because it's been a long time since there's been a lot of packet stuff on air. Danny does a good job with what he does, but he's got physical limitations, as do I, but between the two of us, I'm sure we can work something out. Possibly get another, either a digipeater or preferably a node somewhere, I'm thinking here. so that between the two of us, we can communicate. And
whereabouts are you, Scott?
I'm in Kingston. Just near the Vodafone Towers.
I wasn't after an exact location. You said you couldn't get through to Danny, so I was just...
Well, it's strange. I should. I can hear him occasionally. I think he's using a beam, though, on 575.
Yeah.
And I'm obviously just not in a favourable spot with wherever he's got the beam facing. And I'm just off the side of it. And I'm only using an omnidirectional quarter wave. I'm highly sophisticated. But the quarter wave that's next to it got me into ZL a few years ago, so... the only other thing I really want to cover on this bit here is the 44 network. Amateur radio is fortunate to have a whole IP block dedicated to it, and it just happens to start in the 44 range. Well, it's 44. It's the whole block, the 44. And so there is a governing body, I suppose, is a way to describe it, to keep control of who's got what IP numbers, and that's through this AMPANET. And it's free to apply for one if you want to get a number, or even I've actually been considering actually upgrading, getting a sub-block for myself, because the Australian allocation is not being used as widely as it could be. And that's not saying that it should be used, it's just that there's no longer the interest in doing it, so there's plenty of IP numbers available.
Which is a bit scary, given that
the shortage of...
IP numbers, IPv4 numbers.
Yeah.
I'm amazed they haven't approached...
I'm surprised it hasn't been cut and dissolved and no longer. There's a lot of money sitting in that lock.
Who governs it?
It's governed by this organisation.
Oh, that's that particular one, yeah.
That's the governing body, but as far as who's actually
who's in charge,
Danny's in charge of allocating IPs locally here in Hobart.
They split that down.
Yeah, it's in inter-country.
So Australia's got a
44136 is Australia, and then any beyond that. I forget what New Zealand is. New Zealand's 44 or something.
Because like, I remember, when I started playing with this a long time ago, I actually applied for a number. I got a 44 number. I'm trying to remember. I don't think it was Danny who I applied to, but there was somebody here in VK7 who was looking after it.
Bob, VK7 KRR, used to...
Okay.
He was in Launceston.
Okay.
He's now Silent Key, but he used to deal with it.
Look after it.
In the mid-90s, he dealt with that.
No, that'd be about right.
Yeah.
Because I got it working.
Yeah, yeah.
That was a bit of an intrigue, and then other things came up.
Well, that's it. Now, when you start getting into using like TCP IP encapsulated in AX25, the overheads are huge. And that's why at 1200 baud, it's basically, I say it's unusable. You can do things like ping and trace routes and a little bit of telnet, but as soon as you start wanting to pass bigger amounts of data, that's where it falls over in a heap pretty quick. Unless, if you could make it a dedicated full duplex, then you'd be fine. It'd still be slow, but it'd be fine. It's removing the latency between frames and all that stuff. It's, yeah. I think that's the last slide. Yeah. I think that's about all I can need to cover. I could reminisce about the 90s.
I think we could all reminisce about the 90s.
Well, for example, in Hobart, in the 90s, you used to have 3-packet BBSs. You had Andrew Dixon, VK7GL. You had Will Stubbings, VK7HIL, now 5HIL. And Tony ZTA. I can't remember. He ran a particular BBS that didn't support compression, so he was a bit unfavoured on the frequency at the time. So when BBSs would forward, they used to compress data to obviously not take up as much RF space, and his particular BBS was an older style one that didn't support compression, so everything was sent as a just straight ASCII over the air. And eventually he got the hint and he turned it off and he went away, but I'm not saying that in a negative, that he should have been pushed off the frequency. That's not the case. It was just he should have gone to another BBS system that supported the more modern way of doing it at that given time. So, yeah, 3 BBSs. You used to have the Rose link between Hobart and Launceston. Packet was generally operated on 147.575. There used to be a Digipeater, a Rose... actually, yeah, it was a Rose node here, RTY. Sorry. I said RTY was up in the north. No. Anyway, call signs, I can't really exactly remember, but I'm pretty certain it was RTY. It's popping in my head. They used to sit out in the back room. In fact, I think the antenna for it's been removed, but that's what that crazy looking, I forget what it used to be called, that little dipole thing that used to sit on the shed.
Okay.
That used to run the packet side of things. Then you had Rose node on Guy Fawkes, and that is kind of how RHT ended up on Guy Fawkes from when the NTA tower issue all happened. You know, couldn't afford to stay on that hill, let's move to another one we can afford to, so that went over there, and then eventually that obviously got to the price point.
And that got too expensive.
Yeah. And then it's all here now. but I forget exactly when that Rose node was decommissioned. And I'm not even sure who by. It just kind of, in the north, they switched theirs off long before it got switched off down here.
Okay. So it didn't have anything to communicate with,
basically. Yeah.
Except local.
Well, you see, originally the plan was it was all supposed to be on 575, but somewhere along the line, I can't remember if it was a northern issue or a southern issue, somebody ordered the wrong crystals and they ended up on the wrong frequency. I think it was a southern issue there that we had.
Don't mention the war.
No, exactly. That's basically it. Yeah, yeah. this is before my... See, I got into packet radio in 1996.
Okay.
So that was... And I started on a Commodore 64 using a Bacon modem. Yep. And...
I bought mine in.
I've got a board for one, but I still haven't built it. I've got the chip, and I've got... I just need to buy...
Keep hold of the chip.
Oh, yeah. I've certainly done that. It's one of those round to it projects. I lost the schematic for it though, so I've got to try and.
Oh, okay, I can probably do that one.
It's a slightly different board to that one,
yep.
But it is similar.
Okay.
Andrew Dixon used to sell it back in the day.
So what have we got over here?
Well, that's I suppose we can cover into that.
Yeah.
Obviously, the live stream's probably going to struggle with this. This is just a selection. I suppose you could say it's a museum of some TMCs of mine. This one's not mine, but I do have one like it.
Is it like a car thing where you go classic, vintage?
Well,
veteran.
If you wanted to say that,
okay.
This is the kind of thing you would have started with when you first got on packet radio. It's called a Baycom modem, it's just a serial modem. You would talk whatever, depending on the setup of the Baycom modem, you could either do 300 baud, 1200 baud, 2400 baud, depending on the chip.
Mm.
There was two whirly chips that you could do certain speeds. Obviously, I don't have knowledge of these ones. I'm guessing they're just 300, 200. And it was the same. You used the same serial speed on your... So if you were using 300 baud, you were using 300 baud as a serial link as well. So
and there's 232.
232 yeah. compatible, yeah. RS-232 levels, so your 12-volt
yeah.
swing. And this is software related. All this is just the physical link layer to transfer your zeros and ones to an audio tone. All the brains of it was required by whatever software you were using. In fact, there used to be a terminal program called Baycom, which was designed by said company, Paul Baycom, that had the original design of the circuit board. They were the most popular way of doing packet radio in the 80s. Then it kind of merged into other systems. The best one to describe would be the humble PacCom Tiny 2. This is your staple TNC for packet radio. It's your benchmark, basically. This one is exactly the same thing. Size difference, but it's a clone. This one here is a clone of this one. So you can actually swap the firmware chips of these across, and I've got one at home, which I've swapped out the firmware to TF firmware. Works a treat. This particular one here has actually got the standard PacCom firmware plus an APRS digipeater. It's got a switch on the back here where you can flip.
Okay.
It's got a 512K EEPROM in it, and that switch on the back is just toggling a pin to use the upper or lower register. So you've got two firmwares in one TNC.
Yeah.
The original Tiny 2s didn't have that function,
okay.
But the later ones did. It's an easy mod to make. Cantronics Field. This one here is a dual port TNC. So it operates on the VH, the lower speed port, I think, does 300 baud through 48, and the high speed one does 48 through to 19.2. I think. It's been a while since I've had to think about that.
Is that a 9600 plus?
No, it's a pre plus.
So it only does 9600.
It is capable of 19.2.
Really?
Yeah. But I've never used it at that speed. In fact, I've got two of them, I should try. Good TNC, but the plus ones were better. They had a few more options. When I bought mine in 97, I didn't realise at the time that it had just been discontinued. I should have waited about 6 months and got the plus. But anyway, it happens. This one here is a multi-mode TNC by Cantronics. So it's got packet radio, AMTOR, CYTOR, PACTOR, RTTY, CW, and probably a few others in there. There's probably a covered AMTOR, didn't I? I think there's a WeatherFax mode that's capable of decoding as well. Unfortunately, this one's a bit sick. It needs some new capacitors in the serial line. It's not talking. Covered that one. This one's a more modern equivalent, Tiny Track 4. I'm plugging this one because I'm a beta tester for it. This is the kind of unit you'd buy as you see it. This is one I built up. It's got one of these inside, but I've also included, it's capable to put a 4x16 header, yeah, LCD, and you can actually use this as a dumb terminal.
Oh, okay.
So I've got it set up so you can plug a keyboard into the back. We've got three ports. Oh, one's for a GPS, and that's right, there's two serial ports on the Tiny Track. So one would be a radio port, one would be for another device, like you could feed in a Bluetooth serial link, and then you've got a GPS feed in and serial out, GPS in, radio out. What am I saying? I probably haven't done that. Anyway, haven't used that for years. That's what I used to use for my Sony Gate many years ago. And the humble favourite, this is my personal favourite, is the old PK-232. This one's like a Pink Floyd light show when it's in action on Amtor. All these lovely little LEDs to tell you what's going on. This company actually exists in another form now. It's no longer AEA, it's now called TimeWave. I was having a look at their site last night, and they've actually removed a lot of the kits that they used to have available. This one here is the latter end of the PK-232. They used to just have all red LEDs. And the earlier models were just a PK-232 without the MBX. That just means it's got a mailbox. But you can buy kits where you can upgrade, you can put the mailbox into one that didn't have a mailbox. There's a DSP card that you can put into it. There's a sound card interface you can put into it. And that's exactly what I've got in mine at home, which is running on the APRS gate on 40 metres.
Okay.
That's why I've got a little bit of an affinity with the old PK-232. But yeah, so they're still available in a different format. They still look the same as this, they've just got a different brand name on. But they're about $600 American.
They were expensive at the time, I seem to remember.
Oh yeah, they're an expensive TNC, but if you've got the cash to spare...
Oh, but that's all you need. That's the thing.
Yeah, this is the one box does all kind of thing in hardware. Whereas when we had that slide, for example, where it said, you know, you've got your TNC and sound cards. Obviously, sound cards, you can do whatever. But this was the pre-sound card all-in-one box thing.
And you get the light show with it.
And you get the light show. The Cantronics one was similar, but not as many lights on the front. yeah, I think that's about it. Obviously, free to have a look at these devices at your own leisure. I didn't bring a power supply up to plug them in so you could have a look at what they look like, but I didn't think of that at the time. I think that's about me.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
So did you work out what's causing the logo?
I reckon
there's something in there.
It's got to be in the overhead projector.
It actually had YouTube written on it.
No, I think you've got a notification something happening.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a Chrome notification.
You know what? Bloody right.
Do you have a notification that your own presentation?